You know, I had a chance to watch the tribute video you're about to see, and I'm pretty sure it's the first time in any show that the words Doobie Brother and Weapon Systems apply to the same guy. I'm serious. Now, present our next honor, please welcome a young man who I promise is not here to promote a brand of guitars. Please welcome Jeffrey Fender Wray.
Thank you, Sinbad. I just want to give a shout out to the band. Sounding excellent out there. I just want to go a little off script just in the beginning here and just make note mention of a couple of my idols that just passed away recently. David Bowie, very impactful in my life and what I was listening to. And of course, Glenn. In 1962, when my dad was 14 years old, he wrote a letter to his idols, Bob Bogle and the Ventures. And he asked them what kind of guitar should he play if he wanted to play music like the Ventures. Well, Bob actually wrote him back. And he told him, if you want to play music like us, you should play a Fender Jazzmaster. So that's what he went out and bought. Fender guitars became a central part of his life. And a few years later, my dad was working at the counter at Jimmy's Music Store in New York. Jimi Hendrix came into the store. Well, that day he sold Jimmy a beautiful white Fender Stratocaster. And of course, the rest was history. It's my dad's connection with the Fender guitar that caused my parents to name me after my dad's guitar. And as you might imagine, it's often a fun conversation starter. But what I'm most proud of is my dad's mastery of the guitar. To me, he's one of the all-time greats. And I've had the great fortune to witness his abilities in action, whether it was in the studio, playing live. He can literally play anything. But it's not only his ability, it's the absolute quality and skill of his guitar mastery. And through the years, my name has given me an identity that I can be proud of, almost a legacy. Now, wherever I go and whenever I introduce myself, people know that in some way, my life has been involved with music. And Dad, as many times you have said to me, music is an arrow in my soul. So tonight, I get to honor you for some of your accomplishments. The music that you've made over the years speaks for itself, and it has stood the test of time. And those first three Steely Dan records still hold up today. And the music you made with the Doobies have given us, in some way, something to smile about through the years. All those licks you laid down in the studio for other artists, they made those records better. And for those movies that you scored and those jingles that you wrote, it made better. And I'm pretty sure that there's no one else in this room tonight that can say they had a Muppet modeled after them. But, Dad, beyond your music, because of your work as a defense consultant, you've also made everyone in this room a little safer in their everyday life. And for these things, I want to thank you. I want to tell you how proud I am of you and how honored I am to be your son. Thank you. I'm grateful to be here this evening with you to celebrate your outstanding accomplishments. And I'd also like to share a few greetings from a few family members who couldn't be here tonight. Number one, my sister Faith. She sends her love, Dad. Your grandson, Miles Gibson, and my beautiful wife, Serena, also send their love, and they're very proud of you. And they wanted me to tell you, Papa Skunk, you rock. And of course, my grandparents, your parents, Kit and Loy Baxter, who aren't here tonight with us. No longer with us, I'm sorry. And I feel certain that they are here with us tonight in spirit. They would also be proud of you and would have loved to share this moment with you. Dad, we've been on one hell of a ride, and I look forward to the coming year and the release of your new solo project, and I look forward to sharing your new music with the world. And as they cue this video, I thank you again for all you've done to be a great father, a wonderful role model, and an amazing musician. I love you very much.
And now what?
What?
No, you're going to pick something?
What?
No.
See you later.
Of course I want to play. You're not nervous, are you? Oh, believe it then.
Working at Manny's Music Shop in Manhattan in 1966, a young Jeffrey Skunk Baxter met an equally young Jimi Hendrix, and for a short period that year was the bassist in Jimmy James and the Blue Flames. Skunk Baxter landed his first real gig in 1968 with the psychedelic rock band Ultimate Spinach. He has gone on to have a long and storied career, earning numerous gold and platinum albums, and two Grammys in the process. The walrus mustachioed guitarist was a crucial member of Steely Dan, the Doobie Brothers, and a later iteration of Spirit. Founding member of Steely Dan, he became an important element of the group's high-minded meld of rock, pop, and jazz. From Can't Buy a Thrill through 1974's Pretzel Logic. Rock me a little while. Recruited by the Doobie Brothers, Skunk joined the band for several of their most successful albums. On the hills above Santa Cruz, to the place where I spent my youth. Frequently doubling on steel guitar and adding an essential texture to their hugely popular guitar-driven pop rock. Baxter's versatility and technical wizardry led him to produce albums for artists like Carl Wilson, Nazareth, The Stray Cats, Billy Vera. He has also toured extensively with Elton John.
We got Jeff Baxter.
Julian Lennon.
We got Julian Lennon. And we got you.
And Linda Ronstadt. Skunk became a hugely in-demand session guitarist from the 70s on. And for more than 40 years, he has recorded with such artists as Barbra Streisand, Ringo Starr, Rod Stewart, Cher, John Mellencamp, Roy Orbison, Joni Mitchell, Little Feat, and the Beach Boys. Expanding his session work, he eventually played everything from folk and country to R&B and jazz. With the likes of Dolly Parton, Judy Collins, Richie Havens, The Ventures, and Stanley Clarke, among many others.
Have you ever seen a vampire?
Baxter has also composed music for movies, television, and video, including Beverly Hills 90210, Bull Durham, King of the Hill, and Roxanne. Significantly, he has been a design engineer and consultant for Akai, Audio Technica, Allen & Heath, Fender, and Roland for over 35 years.
guitarist Jeff Baxter, a rock star who's helping the Pentagon with top secret military defense projects.
In the mid-1980s, Baxter's expertise and technological advances led him to hardware that was originally developed for military use. His interest in military hardware and weapon systems led to an appointment in 2001 as a defense analyst.
It keeps you running, yeah, it keeps you running.
He also served as a consultant to several U.S. senators and chairs a congressional advisory board on missile defense.
To me, life is a series of adventures, chapters, and I have a wall full of gold records and platinum records and awards, and I'm very proud of it. But I learned what it meant to have someone say, we need you in room 125A. And you walk in, and there's just two guys there. And they shake your hand and say, thank you very much. You did a good job. I love what I'm doing, and I feel privileged enough to work and be in the fight. So to me, I'm the luckiest man alive.
Guitarist, composer, engineer, producer, and military expert. Jeffrey Skunk Baxter is not only an American guitar hero, but a true American hero. And now, a most deserving member of the NAMM TEC Hall of Fame.
Well, thank you so much. I know it's been a long evening, and I'll keep it short because we want to do some playing. But first of all, I got a shout out to the band as well, because Larry Batiste and these guys, Larry's great. He says, I don't give a damn what kind of award you get, and you show up for sound check at Downbeat at 7. So I'm still a side man, and it makes me feel like $1 million. Thank you, guys. Unbelievable band. And they're going to help us later. Yeah, I've been a very lucky person. I live in a country that's, I'm not going to get weird about patriotism. I'm just happy to be here. I get to work with some amazing people. Life's been very good to me. And guitar's opened up amazing doors for me. I remember one time we were up on the Thai-Burma border, and I can't say what we were doing because we'll all go to jail. But we found a refugee camp with 2,000 kids, and they didn't really have anything, and we found a cigar guitar with 5 strings, and that guitar brought 2,000 kids together to sing Row, Row Your Boat, which may seem a little silly, but it was unbelievable to see what an instrument and what music and what the magic of all that can do for people's hearts. So it's just truly amazing to me. So I want to thank my son, Fender. His mom named him Fender, and my grandson's name Miles Gibson. And if there's an Alvarez Zagari, somebody's dying in their sleep. But it's really hard to figure out what to say. I wish my parents were here. My dad and my mom bought me a guitar. I wanted a bicycle. Pissed me off. I was 9 years old. We grew up in Mexico City, but a year later I managed to find myself in a surf band, and that kind of started. I got to thank my mom for giving me piano lessons and teaching me to read, and all the friends and wonderful people in this room who I've known for way too long. Hopefully we will know each other for many, many, many more years as well. Again, I'd like to thank some other special people too, and again, not to get too sappy, but I'd like to just get a shout out for the men and the women who stand on the wall who allow us to do this. And so other than that, I think it's time to play some music. What do you think, Larry? You think we should do that? And enough of this talk. Again, thank you very much. Thank everybody so much for this. And I'm going to bring another friend of mine up on stage, more than a friend, about 30 years ago. I went to Chicago to start doing a bunch of jingles. And I was sleeping on the couch at Universal Studios and working with these cats. And this gentleman, C.J. Vanson, was a keyboard player on a lot of the dates. We started doing jingles, and then, of course, the day that I really figured out that C.J. was the guy that I wanted to work with on my solo project and play music was, I'll just use the word Bobby W., came in completely fried on a Saturday afternoon that we were doing a session for, I think it was Soul Beer or something like that. He comes in with a chart that's got 64 bars, a time signature, and a key, and that's it.
No, it had the word Hyatt at the time.
Hyatt, that's right, it was for Hyatt. And there's nothing there. He says, you guys will be fine. Let's count it off, it'll be great. So, okay, we counted it off, and we did the jingle, and I realized that there's some people in the world that you can play with that you don't need charts. You just have a great feel for and some kind of a communication. So luckily, CJ is with me tonight. And we're going to do the intro to a song called Ricky Don't Lose That Number. And what we're going to do for the intro, though, is just the way we started out, and it's going to be actually the first tune on the solo record, is called Juliet. But just playing together, the first song on the record is a record that we just wrote while we were playing it. And it's a privilege to have my buddy CJ up here with the guys. These background singers, unbelievable. Nathan's happy because I gave him some clean laundry from the Pentagon last year, so he's good to go. And let's just play some music.